the African, the identity of the African. The blackness is also within the definition of the African, because Afri really means black. Coming out of the Roman experience of meeting I and I. It is the blackness that is what is, we must rally around. African, landmass. But the deeper than the African is the blackness. The philosophy, the psychology, the oneness with the cosmos. Now, language is another aspect of power. And we see the importance of using words like Negro, that it actually disempowers the African. It has the African defining himself as a walking dead. You have to be careful what you define yourself as. You will certainly act it out. So the powers of words. Rastafari always speak about word, sound, and power. I want to warn them. Get your pen and a piece of paper. It's part of the tools of the metamorphosis. You know? Pen and paper and dictionary and Bible and world map. These are tools that help I and I in this self-extrication process. Now you see, if you write the word M-A-N, when you write the word M-A-N, man, and that's a root word in the language that we have been given, man. If you spell man with a small M, it refers to a singular person. Because in the language that we have been given to use, we are introduced to terms of like singular and plural. Now, singular and plural are two important ideas, very important ideas in communication. One versus many, singular versus plural. And they teach you how to make words that are singular, plural. One of the easiest ways is normally to put a S on the word. So if the word is singular and you put a S on it, it means you're talking about plenty now, many. Singular and plural. Boy, I'm dealing with that. So we are familiar with that, right? Okay. So I want you to write M-A-N. And if you write a capital M for man, it means no, you're not talking about a single man. You're talking about plenty males. And the capital M would also now want to include plenty females. So this is what the language does now, you know. The capital M for man means many males, whole heap of males, or it means all males and females. That is the big man. Small M refers to a single male. So now we're going to work on the idea now of singular and plural. Now, man is singular. And the plural of man is men. M-E-N. So you have man and you have men. And this is a international understanding, global. That's how English work, man and men. I would say man now is a root word, so you can attach words to man. You can put words in the prefixes in the front, and you can put a suffix in the, at the back. So you can manipulate now this root word called man. If you put W-O in front of man, you get woman, singular. If you want to pluralize woman, you seem to say woman. Because the plural of man is men. That kind of straightforward, you see? So we have man and men, we have woman, and we have women. Again, we say man is a root word. Now when we attach hue in front of man, we get human. When we say pluralize human, we're supposed to say human. The same way you say woman and woman. But no, something changed here. No longer is it human. Them say the plural of human is humans. No, I want to want them look carefully now between these lines. Because you see, if you examine human, which is what the plural is supposed to be, human now begin to open up the imagination and it begin to give you a sort of idea of a set of men with hue. Yeah, human. And you may want to explore further what really is hue. What does hue mean? And hue, in its meaning, really refers to vibrations. Hues are vibrations of light. Another word for hues are colors. And you begin to perhaps sight up now that this notion of human really would refer to colored men. Men of color. But don't be confused. Because the black man is not a man of color. The black man is a man who has absorbed all light within. So who are the human? Who are the men who change color? Who can sometimes become red or blue? Human. It's a notion. And I'm saying that the human are an entity that black people must examine. Who are these human? Metamorphosis continuing, we go into our story, Alkibulan, Kemetic philosophy. These stories that are not related to us, story that we have to uncover ourselves and reconfigure and reconstruct. Yeah, much has been hidden, much has been buried, but much is still here. The Africans have contributed so much to this state of world affairs in his technological and cultural and spiritual knowledge. The area that we are often not given much credit for is the area of science and technology. African people are made to feel as though we were in the caves, when we know the total opposite. We know that while the Europeans were in the caves, the Dogons were communicating with life forces from outside of the solar system. So, and I want to look into the scientific, historical nature of African people. When I look at the continent and its geographical makeup, geological makeup, God, this is a very vast place. The documents show that the desert that is now called the Sahara, that massive desert, the documents are showing that historically this was not always a desert. That in hundreds of thousands of years ago, that this area was an ocean. Now, if you can extend your imagination beyond the borders that have been given to you about the beginning, and think of the African, that continent with an ocean where the Sahara Desert is now, you would realize that there were connections by sea across Africa. You could go across Africa by water from east to west. That the cultures of the Mali and the West Africans were connected to the cultures of the Egyptians on the other side. And it is reflected in the art, reflected in the philosophy, reflected in the astronomy. Yeah, the African people moving across the continent, having technology about sailing, shipbuilding, marine life. So we don't want anybody come and try to tell us, say, we just come. And we just have come out of some barbaric situation. We are the foundation of culture on this planet. The western side of Africa, much of our knowledge is just through the slave trade. You ask a man what he know about West Africa, he started telling about the slave trade, he started telling about Ghana and Nigeria. He doesn't tell you about Mali. He doesn't tell you about the Islamic reign in Africa and the Islamic high culture. He doesn't tell you about the astronomy of the Dogon people, that the Dogons had contact with beings from a different solar system, a different constellation. All this might sound like fairy tale, you know. But the Europeans presently are heading towards Mars, using up all of the resources of the planet Earth to find out what is on Mars. As I speak to the item, there is a 3 vehicles circling Mars. 2 from the United States. Yeah? And 1 from European Union. And why is it they are spending their time circling? 1 from Europe and 2 Americans. 3 spacecraft now circling Mars. The Americans also have 2 rovers exploring the surface. Now, black people, I talk to the item now. What do you think could be attracting the entire scientific community on the earth, whites and Indians and Chinese, to explore places like Mars? Why should they be sending unmanned vehicles beyond Pluto? Why have the Americans renamed their next set of vehicles Orion? You see, African culture was conscious of Orion. The Dogons were conscious of Orion because the star Sirius is within the constellation of Orion. Sirius is not so far from Osiris, the sun god, the culture of Egypt, the culture of the Mali, the Sphinx. Looking at Sirius, we have to wake up our astronomical brains. We have to begin to see black man not just as a terrestrial being. We have to begin to see black man as a galactical being. We have to break out of this Garden of Eden genetic story and reclaim the cosmos. It's a serious thing. We are totally disconnected from the cosmos. And our fear of the underworld, where the minerals are, and our desire to go to heaven, which is a land above, causing us all sorts of conflicts. African people, in reclaiming black history, we have to reclaim science, we have to reclaim astronomy, not astrology, not that prediction of how you must behave. We're talking about the connections at the cosmic level. African people must recognize that our genesis is not necessarily from this planet Earth. Our genesis could also have been from a place called Sirius. That's what the Dogons think. The Dogons are African people. And as an African, thinking about it. Expeditions by most of the scientifically driven nations is heading towards Mars. The people of Africa, the black people, is it that we have no interest? We think it's a white man thing that? Is that we are so disconnected from technology, from research of the cosmos and the galaxies, that we are buried into this Christendom? We are buried into the coming of the Lord. It is not simple to simply ignore what we see at nights. When we look into the heavens at nights, we see the infinitude of existence. It is not possible. And the scientific evidence is coming in that it is not possible that this planet has the only form of life that could be considered intelligent. It is not possible. And the pictures and the images are coming in. Everybody is getting conscious. Space is becoming the frontier for tourism. So we can't stay on the ground here and keep talking about the battle between good and evil. The battle is not between good and evil, it's between the powerful and the powerless. There's no good and evil struggle here. It's about the powerful and the powerless. The powerful have military arms. The powerful have money. The powerless are defenseless. And they do have no money. Suffering from no money syndrome.
That duty I owe to posterity. Great Zimbabwe stands, ancient rocks are the firm. Come now, Jacob got down.
How many people have ever looked at a map carefully and look at the fitting of Africa and South America? How many people have ever looked on that map carefully realize that the South Atlantic Ocean, if we just squeeze up that space and remove the South Atlantic Ocean, Africa and South America, we are just 15. And so you see the similarity in the culture along the coastlines. There have been great shifts in the continents over the millions of years. Obviously, the landmass have shifted to volcanic eruptions and meteorite impacts. But we can see that much of what is here now was connected. Yeah, man, we have imagination. Look at the world map. Look at the pieces. Yes, one big Atlantis, one world island, one island continent. Atlantis, Mu, Lemuria. Yes, black people. Zimbabwe, now, there are two vessels, vehicles being driven on Mars as I speak, two rovers digging up Mars and examining the material and sending forward pictures, etc., etc. Now, as a man on the earth here and conscious of how we have been trained to believe creation as a story, makes a man wonder about Mars. Is there a hell on Mars? Yeah, is there a hell on Mars? Is there a hell under the ground in Mars? And is there a devil that occupies Mars the way the devil occupies the earth? Is there any Satan on Mars? What about Jupiter, where we go there? Are there any devils on Jupiter? Or is this an earth thing created by men on earth? Them said at the center of the earth, it's very hot. And the devil lives at the center of the earth. Of course, you know, nobody has ever been to the center of the earth. Open up the imagination, scientific knowledge. Where is the devil? Where is hell? There's an international space station 220 miles above. Heaven must be above the space station. It must be above the moon. It must be beyond Mars. It must be outside the solar system, because we have already sent vehicles outside. So if anybody want to go to heaven, be prepared to journey outside of this solar system. Good luck. Titchfield people on the hills there playing the dominoes and getting into it. Yes, Claude and... Yeah, man, get down, stand the love. Hey, Dr. Ras Makonnen, Osa Osa Bora, Ras Jangai, Rastafari University of Aya, live learning.
If you're ready, make with it. And if you're ready, make with it. And if you're ready, make with it. And if you're ready, make with it. I make with it, I make with it.
So you see why we're suffering. We've been believing for so long in the things that we don't understand, but we've been believing them to the death, and we'll die in defense of some of those beliefs. That is heavy programming, you know. That is heavy, heavy brainwashing. But it's been done to us, and the work is to undo it. Yeah, man, anything that is done can be undone. May take a little bit more time, but perseverance. Yeah, man, perseverance. Now, the book that has captured our imaginations is the King James Version of reality. Of course, there was reality before King James Version came together. Yes, there was reality long before the birth of King James. There's reality long before the birth of Moses. There's reality long before Abraham was created and born, long before the stories of Adam and Eve were written. It was reality. The Africans had their reality. The Dogons, the Egyptians, the people of Zimbabwe, the San people, the Congo people, the Oriental people, all had their realities. It is upon our original oral reality now that a certain thing is going to be foisted upon us. A reality that is going to be constructed and designed. That once we embrace that reality, we embrace a thought of slavery. And we'll end up defending that slavery to the death. Because in defending that slavery to the death, the prize comes at the end. The prize is this ticket to this place. Beyond the space station. Beyond Mars. Beyond Pluto. A ticket to this place. Far, far away.